So look, guys, I've had my eye on this story for a while now. It's by Lord Eliorth over on D&D Green Text. I really enjoy it. I think it's outstanding. You guys know how much I love fucking, like, mono parties, like the old guard party, the old barbarian, and the old bard. Well, this is the old paladin party, so, like, I hope you boys enjoy it. I've had some technical difficulties trying to get this video up and running. I've had to change voices, but like, hopefully we'll be back to the normal voice in the very near future. So without further ado, let's just get the show on the road, will we?
Be me, be not me, be my friends. Sets up D&D game. Eternal DM curse.jpg. Wanted to play a paladin. Oh well, DMing is fun too. Friends make the characters on their own. They've played before, so I think I'll be okay letting them come up with stuff. Session 1. Party is all in a wagon traveling through the maze-like northern mountains to the mythical Summerland, a place where the Feywild is close enough to bless a northern section of the world with fertility and warmth. Also gets routinely invaded by monstrous races and conquered. Party is heading northwards to try to help establish a new colony. Alright, you're all in the wagon. Introduce yourselves. Cazador Orchama, a huge red dragonborn who speaks with a dwarvish accent and carries the cross axes of Clangadon on his breastplate with two axes at his side. Peregrine Horserider, a happy-go-lucky halfling in armor that seems a bit too nice for him, carrying two short swords on his belt and on his chest that he claims are symbols of Avery. Yndri Silverthorn, a tall elven woman with hair silver before its time, clad in a long cloak marked with the moonbow. Senkit, a tiefling out of the southern lands across the seas, with crimson skin, golden eyes, and a calm smile that never leaves his face. Julian Taran, probably a human, but he's never taken his helmet off where anyone can see it, so who knows. Okay, can I get your classes please? Vengeance Paladin, Redemption Paladin, Ancients Paladin, Devotion Paladin, Conquest Paladin, holdup.png. Party has grins all around. They planned this, didn't they? Fine, guess I am now the Paladin. Daresfall.mp3. Session continued. Gonna need a new post since this one's getting long. Be me, Eternal DM. Be not me, Cazador, Peregrine, Yndri, Senkit, and Julian, all paladins. Party is heading north to the Summerland. Been traveling with a colony caravan for a few weeks, should be almost there. Hear a commotion up ahead, goes to investigate. Scouts are on their way back running like hell with four goblins riding two particularly evil looking wolves on the tails. Yndri recognizes them as wargs. Cazador doesn't care, tells them to get ready to fight. I agree, roll for initiative. Peregrine goes first, rushes up and hits warg with a stone from his sling, orders the caravan back. Yndri is next, a bow twangs, a warg gets an arrow in the knee, slows down. Goblins shoot back, roll poorly. Wargs close on the scouts and knock one down. Cazador rushes forwards and Misty steps forwards to slam his axe into the first warg's mouth, throwing it off the scout. Senkit dashes to get between the other scout and the next warg. Julian takes a pot shot with his crossbow, goes wide. Peregrine draws his swords and jumps up on the warg's back, kicking off one goblin and slashing the other. Yndri puts an arrow past him into the wounded goblin's throat. Dead goblin, floor gobbo aims for Cazador's knees, can't get through the armor. Warg goes for his throat, gets his arm instead. Other warg and its gobbos go for Senkit, she takes some serious hits. Cazador removes the warg's ears with one axe, and a chunk of its chest with the other. Senkit gets mad, eyes glow, and a searing smite turns one goblin's chest into a smoking crater. Julian puts a bolt into the wounded warg, drops it. Peregrine rolls off the dead warg and hits the grounded gobbo in the back of the head. Out cold. Yndri misses her shot. Warg turns and tries to get out of there. Cazador turns and fries warg and his rider with a blast from his jaws. Senkit and Julian bring it down with crossbow bolts. Some laid on hands patch up Cazador and Senkit. Cazador is confused as to why the halfling has one of the goblins over his shoulder and is setting a pot on the fire for tea. I ken ye wee scunners were hungry, but I nay ken ye'd even scoff Groby. Yes, he is extremely Scottish. I'm not gonna eat him. There's not enough spices in the world to make it tasty. I'm making some tea for both of us. Why are you making the overgrown green rat tea? Yndri asks, still confused. It's almost tea time, and tea is the best time for chatting. So you're going to interrogate him? I've never seen tea used as a torture device, have you, Firebrand? Julian jokes, mostly aimed at Senkit. The tiefling is unamused. Torture isn't my area of expertise, nor is it a halfling field of study. You're crazy. I'm just gonna make him a cup, ask him a few questions, and send him on his way. Peregrine explains as he pours a couple mugs and waves one under the goblin's nose to wake him up. MHM. Some tin smells good. The gobbo murmurs as he wakes up, then starts and looks around, freaking out slightly when he realizes he's surrounded by paladins. Oh Zog. Disange Acheron. You're not dead yet. Want some tea? After some conversation and some Chanel divinity-assisted diplomacy roles, they figure out the gobbo named Runtgut is a part of a rather large goblinoid war host that controls the southernmost part of the Summerlands, based out of an old abbey and led by Darboss. Darboss apparently just recently took control of the pass by taking over one of the old dwarven watchtowers and sending his son with some forces to catch any caravans coming through. Party decides they need to take back the watchtower before the caravan moves on. Cazador wants to just match up the road, killing everything. Party convinces him to take a subtler route. Runtgut mentions there's a back way around that the wolf riders and bugbears would take to flank. He could lead them there. Arguing ensues. Peregrine trusts him. Julian and Senkit are being pragmatic about it and think it's probably a risk worth taking. YNDRI and Cazador are flatly against it. Eventually decide to follow it, with the condition that the goblin is on a leash. Runtgut is not at all happy about this. Party goes to talk to the caravan leader. Julian stays behind to watch Runtgut. Julian threatens to cut off his arms, shove them up his ass, chop off his feet one toe at a time, flay him with a cheese grater, and then fling him into a barrel of lemon juice and horse piss. Then fling said barrel into a river if he betrays them. Holy shit, calm down, dude, I know you're lawful evil, but that's just not kosher. Not gonna make him roll for intimidation, though. Table universally agrees that was rather creative, but also way too evil. Julian agrees to slightly less Night Haunter-esque intimidation in future. Rest of party meets with caravan leader and convinces him to wait until they clear out the watchtower. This is getting long again, goddammit. Gonna need a part 3. Be me. Be not me. Cazador, Senkit, YNDRI, Peregrine, and Julian. All paladins all the time. Party is being led by Runtgut the gobbo to go and kill a bunch of goblinoids that took over a dwarven watchtower. Operation Sneaky Breaky is a go. Party immediately rolls less than 10 on all stealth checks. Coin flip says the other wolf patrols aren't active at the moment. Party passes by an area thick with trees and shrubbery on one side and a cliff edge on the other. YNDRI smells something, realizes they're passing by bugbear dens. Oh shit.png. Three bugbears jump out of the brush. Julian gets hit in the helmet. It is now dented and stuck on his face. Senkit is beat on for the second time today. Peregrine is used as a golf ball. I'm going to need a lot of lemons, Julian says. YNDRI pulls her sword and starts stabbing. Cazador grabs a bugbear by the beard and starts dragging him towards the cliff. Julian draws his greatsword and smites the bugbear in the chest. Peregrine rolls between the bugbear's legs, kicks him in the jollies, and runs for the trees, dodging the opportunity attack. Senkit is getting real tired of getting beat up and delivers her morning star into the bugbear's face with a crit. This is how you bludgeon someone, you oversized carpet. Bugbear struggles with Cazador but can't break free. Second one puts another dent in Julian's armor, and the third chases the halfling into the trees. Julian and YNDRI team up on the bugbear. Senkit decides that 3-on-1 would be dishonorable and goes to help Peregrine. Peregrine clambers up a tree to keep his bugbear distracted, allowing Senkit to walk up behind it, tap it on the shoulder, and then smash its shoulder in. Cazador rolls very well on his grapple check and lifts the bugbear over his head before flinging it off the cliff. Bugbear survived the fall, much to Cazador's chagrin. Bugbear on the fall starts nopping out of there. Bugbear in the trees misses. YNDRI hears Cazador cursing in Dwarvish, walks over and shoots the running bugbear in the back of the head. Cazador gives her the slightest of nods. Nice shot, knife ears. That's two for me and one for you, scales. MFW, the starting a competition. Tolkien approves. Julian hears noises in the bushes and wanders over. Senkit orders him back. Peregrine shouts encouragements from the trees. Senkit shows the bugbear who the real master of morning stars is by putting hers through his skull. Julian remembers the gobbo. Gobbo claims he never knew the bugbears were there. A whole bunch of inside checks say he's telling the truth. Rapid lemon purchasing is avoided. Party continues on, soon comes upon the backside of the watchtower. It's surrounded by a small hobgoblin camp. Wolves are relaxing around between tower and fences. Gobbos are walking around poorly built shacks. Hobbs are coming and going out of the tower. Party decides to pull back and wait until morning to attack, since the goblins will have an advantage in the dark. Peregrine decides to start character interaction. So, you're a dragonborn with a dwarvish name, dwarvish accent, with a dwarven god on your chest. What happened? Wizard spell. Angry druid. Just happened to grow up 8 feet tall and with a really weird skin condition. Cazador chuckles slightly. Nay laddie, I'm Drakefic hatched. Nay long ago Tarklan dat would be mine was out a hall en home, driven out by a fell red drake and his servants the scunners who sired me among em. When my laird Belfort came back and slew the old worm, the Drakefic left and left me egg behind. Me father had lost his son in the fighting, so when he found me he took me in, son vera son, grudge vera grudge. The priests ken I'd be a warrior, so they told him to give me ver clangudan. So, as I am, and out here he sent me to take back the whole St. Hall's lost Targroby and worse. How did you even fit in a dwarf hold? YNDRI asks. They built taller than ye'd think. he answered. At this point they set up camp and rest, setting watches. Senkit continues to have the worst luck, as it's during her watch that the Wag Riders start moving, heading out and moving towards the party. Senkit wakes the party and they pull back to the bugbear area. Julian gets the idea to set a trap by bending back trees. He, Hazador, and Senkit set up a tree each. Yndri climbs a different tree and gets out her bow. Peregrine walks out into the middle of the road as bait. Three wolves, six goblins, all headed this way. They move to run down the stupid halfling. Snap, snap, snap. Three trees come up, flinging four goblins off and slamming one particularly unlucky wolf in the face, flipping it over. An arrow from Yndri nails a standing wolf, and it severely regrets its life choices, especially when two short swords leap from the scabbards. Blades flash in the moonlight. A second later, the wolf's head and body hit the ground with wet thuds. Cazador rolls a nat 20 on initiative and with surprising speed rushes from the woods, clearing into goblins with fury, leaving one a bloody pulp. The disorganized goblins rush about. Two rush Peregrine, driving him back with help from the other wolf, who takes the chunk out of his prodigious gut. Two more rush for the cover of the trees and fire poorly at Yndri. The partner of Cazador's victim turns and flees. Senkit comes to his aid, Morningstar and Shield knocking one goblin to the floor, then pulverizing it. Yndri ignores the amateurs and wounds the fleeing goblin before he can get help. Peregrine focuses on the goblin and lands a cut over her heart. Julian cuts one of the archers in half with a single mighty strike. Cazador moves to finish off the fleeing goblin with extreme contempt, cowardly Groby. The archer can't get through Julian's armor, but the wolf takes a chunk from Peregrine's leg. The wounded gobbo looks as though she's about to take advantage and lay into his neck, but she steps on the severed wolf's head and slips, keeping her footing but going wide. I slightly curse Peregrine for taking lucky when I have them all a first level feat. Senkit puts an end to that by shoving the wolf off with her shield, smashing out several of its teeth with another swipe. Yndri turns to the archer and puts an arrow through his shoulder. Julian finishes him a moment later. Peregrine slashes off the goblin's hand and then drives his other sword through her chest. You are really pretty good. You almost had me, he says slightly sadly before the light dies from her eyes. The party hides the bodies in the bugbear's burrows. Peregrine says a brief prayer. Don't waste your words. They're just goblins, Yndri tells him. Oh, and nice job taking the lead, Orchimer. Killing folk isn't a happy thing, even if they're wicked folk, Peregrine responds. Redemption paladin.mp4. Gonna need another part because this is getting too long again. Be me. Be not me, Cazador the 8-foot scaled dwarf, Peregrine the halfling, Senkid the tiefling, Yndri the moon elf, and Julian the guy with a helmet stuck on his head. After several failed strength rolls and 1d4 damage from a sprained neck, the party quits trying to remove Sir Buckethead's helmet and gets back to the adventure. All the gobbos and wolves are now dead, so they get the rest of their rest. In the morning, they're up and looking at the watchtower. The hobs are busy searching all over for the goblins and licking their wound. One hob with a particularly big gex is casting healing magic, and one dressed in mage's robes heads inside the tower. Decide charging in is suicide. Time to try sneaky again. Scouting around renewals a gap they've been throwing all their rubbish out of. Too big for a medium creature, but a small one. Peregrine is not happy as he successfully sneaks into the camp and spies a weak point in the defenses, an area where only one guard is watching. Back down the chute, Cazador spots something in the rubbish. It's a warhammer, the kind that normal hangs in a shrine to Moradin. He takes it and looks very grave. Peregrine signals to Yndri, who alerts Julian. Crossbow, longbow, and two short swords are aimed at the lonely, tired wall guard. He never stood a chance. With a boost from Cazador, the party gets over and hauls the less than jolly red giant over after them. What follows is nothing less than the most absurd series of dice rolls I have seen in some time. Two 20s, a 19, an 18, and a 15. The paladins have been blessed by the Slavic god of Sneaky Breaky, getting them across the open grounds to the doors of the watchtower. Along the way they see the hobs have set up a small forge and are using an usually ornate anvil. It doesn't take a genius to realize they stole the anvil from Moradin's shrine. Cazador is about to spontaneously multiclass into barbarian, successfully sneak into the watchtower. They see the watchroom has been thoroughly looted and what was once a small shrine to Tamoradin has been replaced with a headsman's block, the heads of the dwarven occupants hanging above it. Cazador loses it, storms out, grabs a very surprised hobgoblin guard and bellows at him. Go get your priest. Tell him Moradin's son has come to take his father's shrine back. Rest of the party face palms. We pretty much agree this is how Cazador would act and I even give him inspiration for playing to his character. Paladin's gonna paladin. Cazador stalks back inside as the guard begins to sound the alarm and waits, axes drawn. Senkit moves to throw the mechanism to slam shut the doors once the priest enters. Rest of the party heads upstairs to take up sniper position. There's some rather panicky hobs up there. Priest Hob shows up, sees exactly one paladin waiting for him and walks forwards, drawing his axe. So where's this so-called son of Moradin? All I see is a dead lizard. Where's the wee priest I the SAE called greatest air conquers? All I see is a cowardly slave of a cowardly excuse vera deity who can a even beat a one-eyed old man without swamp and immense bodies. After having received this insult to both self and savior, the priest failed his wisdom save and charged. Peregrine leaps on the nearest hob, putting him down with two short swords in his stomach, the second a smite of golden light to make sure the job is done. YNDR and Julian follow suit. Indri's smite is less an explosion and more a sudden crescent moon that bisects her target, while Julian's is a straight-up flare of violent crimson light that turns his victim into a fine red mist. They all hear movement from the third floor. Once the priest is through, Senkit throws the lever and the dwarven doors slam shut. Cazador charges and axes clash, twin silver biting and cleaving into single blood-stained, neither goblin scale nor dwarven chain yielding a for the mutual onslaught. Senkit isn't getting involved. She's playing devotion oaths on a requirement pretty hard. She does stick her head out the window and summon a spiritual weapon and whack a hob with a ghostly spear. The hob mage looks down the stairs, sees the party, and hurls a fireball. Party scatters, he rolls poorly on the damage dice. Peregrine isn't having any of this and charges up the stairs, dashing to get close enough and slash him with his offhand weapon. YNDRI takes cover and misses her arrow at him. Julian misty steps, runs, and delivers a war god blessed smite directly into the hobgoblin's bright blue nose. Doesn't need a blessing because it crits and deletes the mage from existence. I need to remember to close doors in the future. Back down on the ground floor, the priest summons a phantom axe which bites into Cazador's thigh. He answers with two axes in the hob's chest. The hob retaliates with a strike that sweeps one of Cazador's axes out of his hand. Upstairs party spend the next round healing off their rather sizable burns while the hobgoblins outside try to break down the door. Peregrine finds some scrolls in the hob's satchel that he can't read. Senkit continues using her phantom sword to keep stabbing goblins while attempting to barricade the door. With his newly freed claw, Cazador grabs the hobgoblin. The priest responds with axe phantom and physical, battering the stubborn dragonborn. YNDRI can identify the scrolls, and finds a scroll of fireball. Meanwhile, Julian and Peregrine find to their horror that a crossbow string and leather string don't handle being set on fire all that well. The door is starting to crack, and Senkit informs Cazador of this. Cazador responds, I'm a wee bit busy here, laddie. Cazador rolls a nat 20 and body slams the priest onto his own altar. Switching to the sacred hammer, he raises his arm high and brings it down with a smite. The sound of an anvil rings out as the priest is smashed into the chopping block with such force that it cracks. He struggles, axe striking and prayers to Magula Bet growing ever more desperate. Peregrine, having more courage than good sense, leaps out the window and onto the back lines of the startled hobgoblins, slaying two. After adjusting her aim slightly, YNDRI unleashes the fireball into the front of the hobs, which also happens to be the straw that breaks the watchtower's door, much to Senkit's chagrin. Julian watches the crazy halfling and says when in Waterdeep. As he steps to the ledge, two angelic wings sprout from his back, as Julian the Asimo descends to bring death upon the hobgoblins, without full damage. Cazador raises his hammer once more, for CLANGEDIN. He bellows as he delivers his last smite of the day. The blow shatters priest and altar in a blinding flash of light, and the bloodied paladin turns to wreak further vengeance upon the trespassing Groby. Senkit turns to the hobgoblins and raises her morning star, which begins to glow with the light of the sun as she charges forth and fells another. Fireballed, attacked on all sides, leadless, and facing a whole bunch of crazy zealots, the hobgoblins break and run. Although bloodied, the paladins are victorious. YNDRI returns to inform the caravan, while the others rest and mend their wounds with what spells they have left. They look onwards from the watchtower into the unknown summerland. Lands of untold bounty and countless histories, defiled and bent beneath the heels of great warlords of goblin kind and worse. Their adventure, nay, their crusade, is only beginning. Be me, Paladiem. Be not me, be the paladin party. Cazador the 8 feet scaled dwarf for a vengeance, Senkid the tiefling of devotion, YNDRI the elfin ancient, Peregrine the halfling of redemption, and Julian bucket-headed Asimar of conquest. Paladins just recently began their merry crusade into the summer lands by cleaving, smiting, and hammering their way through a hobgoblin garrison to retake an old dwarven watchtower. Rest of the colony caravan finally arrives along with YNDRI. They find a lot of dead hobgoblins, some rather bloodied paladins, and a roaring fire that Peregrine has gotten to work setting. Ladies and gentlemen of this fine colonization effort, it is my privilege to welcome you at last to the Summerlands, Peregrine chirps to the leaders. Quit clowning around and help me move this anvil, Cazador grumbles good-naturedly as he hauls the anvil back into its place on the shrine. Meanwhile, Senkit is continuing to try to remove Julian's helmet with little success. The caravan moves into the old camp for now and they dispose of the bodies, equipping themselves with what armor and weapons they can find. Senkit, Julian, Cazador meet with the caravan leader, filling him in. Peregrine and YNDRI set out to scout the forest at the base of the hill and do a bit of hunting. After some serious discussion, it's agreed that the paladins will work as scouts and outriders to investigate the forest and try to find a good place to set up. Meanwhile, down the hill, YNDRI spies and brings down an elk with her bow. Peregrine meanwhile finds a running stream to lay his net and line in. While he reclines and waits for a bite, he hears sound in the brush on the opposite side of the stream. He climbs up a tree and balances across a limb to peer through the other side. He spots a troop of halflings carrying a canoe quickly and quietly through the bushes. He shouts a greeting in halfling and is answered with a hail of stones and darts which send him stumbling off his branch into the stream with a loud splash. YNDRI hears the sound and rushes to help, only to find Peregrine and a large number of fish tangled up in his net. She hauls the waterlogged wanderer out along with his catch. "For such a slippery swordsman, you're remarkably clumsy, little one," she remarks with a wry grin on her face. "I didn't fall, I was pushed, from a distance, by a lot of pebbles and darks. There's other halflings here," he burbles out, his unexpected bath doing nothing to blunt his joviality. "Well, that explains it. They clearly knew how much trouble you'd be if you followed them, and probably hadn't enough food for another mouth, especially one as big as yours. Harumph, curl their hair if that's what it was. Not sharing food is just plain selfish. I'd make it back in quality anyways. Of course, let's get back so we've time to report and you can back those words up." The two head back and make their report. Nobody is particularly concerned, for halflings are most always goodly folk, and with a goblinoid horde lighting the land, it stands to reason that they'd be particularly cautious. As the day dims, the fire is built up and Peregrine gets to work cooking. As he's cooking the elk, a stiff breeze blows ashes up towards his meat, only to switch at the last second and instead sweep up wild herbs into the fire, filling the air with a delectable aroma. Everyone enjoys the meal. Cazador in particular thoroughly enjoys the meat, drawing a few wry grins from Senkit and YNDRI. Julian suddenly realizes to his horror that he can't eat due to still having his helmet stuck on. Several minutes of yanking, pulling, and general neck-wrenching ensue before Peregrine gets the idea to lube it off using grease from the meal. One batch of screaming later, the party finally gets to see what Julian looks like. Roll me a d100 and add your charisma score for attractiveness, 25, with bonus. "I'm sorry, Julian, but you have been severely beaten with the ugly stick. Senkit, you sure it wasn't just the morning star? Could have been that." Rest of the party decides to roll for attractiveness. Everyone else rolls 70 plus before modifies, the worst being Cazador with a paltry 88 and the highest being Senkit with a whopping 120. Apparently she's inherited her mother's fiendish charms. Many chucklings and an agreement that if the situation ever calls for seduction rather than smiting, Senkit is the one to do it. As the feast winds down, Peregrine gets out his pipe and begins to smoke, hand on his belly as he digests. "It's only right and proper that we have a tale aid the digestion, and as the only properly sized fellow here, I suppose it falls to me to tell it. What sort would you care to hear?" Senkit pipes up. "I've never seen that crest you wear. How did you come by it?" He smiles. "These are the swords of Ivori, halfling god of war. Not many know him since we're not the sort to go conquering. War's a nasty business, make you late for supper. But sometimes war comes to us, despite the goddess's best efforts. Sir, it was in Avery's day, when Tiamat still walked this plain. Faces scowl and more than a few harsh glares are thrown Cazador's way at the mention of the Dragon Queen. The Dragon Queen's avarice was so great that all the world would be her hoard, the villages of the halflings included. So her armies came, and for a while, Ivori beat him back, armed only with a stout staff. Until she herself came and slew the valiant warrior with her fell breath of every color. He awoke in that golden shire the goddess prepares for us, and there at once sought her out. He begged her to teach him where to find the weapons to save his people and defeat this evil. She told him, and so out he went. Down, 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 into that darkest of places, the abyss, to the dominion of Orcus, Prince of Undeath. He snuck into that mausoleum palace to where the unliving lord slept and stole his front two teeth. In his hands, the rotted fangs became two swords sized for him. With these, whom he named Dragon Biter and Drake Muncher, he cut his way back into the world of the living and drove Tiamat and her legions back into the Nine Hells, stealing away a portion of her godly essence so that he might watch us forevermore. A fell tale and such wicked weapon. Not something I expected from the little folk, YNDRI admits. I said much the same when the priests first told it to me. But there's a lesson in it, like all proper tales. Every weapon, no matter how pretty it is or how righteous the cause it strikes for, is a tool for death. He turns his cloak, and in the firelight all can see his short swords have hilts of bone. For this reason all we who follow Ivori carry swords with bone hilts, to remind us how great and terrible a thing we carry, and to not use it lightly. With that, the story closes, and the evening with it. Soon guards are posted, and beds gone too. In the dead of night, Peregrine awakes to find YNDRI tossing and turning in her sleep. Also, YNDRI is actually sleeping, not entering trance. The very confused halfling quickly shakes her awake and gets a dagger at his throat for the trouble. "Easy on, I'm just the cook. I know the deer might have given you some indigestion, but killing me is a gross overreaction. The pale-haired elf relaxes as she slips the dagger back in her boot. Sorry, little one, you startled me. It's okay, I didn't realize elves had nightmares. I didn't think you even slept, really. Most of us don't. We enter a trance where we relive the memories of our past life. Oh, so why weren't you doing that? She frowns. That's rather personal, little one. I promise I won't tell a soul. You can trust me, honest. I'm sorry, little one, but this isn't. It's not for anyone but me and my own goddess to puzzle out. Peregrine is somewhat sad and confused, but he nods with acceptance. Alright, I won't tell anyone. Meanwhile, YNDRI isn't the only one having bad dreams. Senkit is in a forest. It is dark there, dark without moon or stars, only her diabolical vision can see. The trees are strangled, countless vines like a billion grasping arms, pulsing with life like black veins throttle them. She calls for her light, the light of the sun she bears. Her morning star flares and the dark veins slip away from her. In the distance, she can see a similar light. She heads towards it, walking an ancient and forgotten road past a long abandoned chapel. She comes through the clearing and sees a building, wreathed in solar flames, an ancient abbey burning as a beacon, though like the last embers of an intended fire. Above the gate, a lone tiefling stands, holding a mighty sword in his hands against the pulsing dark. He turns and looks directly at her, one word burnt into her mind as she awakens, the light of dawn burning her eyes. Come.
So yeah, guys, sorry about the voice. Hopefully we're back on track very soon. And like the elf named Yindri, some voices just act differently. So like, it's just issues and I'm going to have to sort out. So sorry about all that, but like, if I didn't just work with it and just get it done, you know, we wouldn't have been able to start, you know. So hopefully we're back on track soon, you know, that's all I can say. But like, enough of all that fucking technical difficulties, that shit's gay. What I'm really here to talk about is this fucking D&D campaign. Right, you know, what I'm really excited about is because I haven't really done a D&D campaign in a long time, like, you know, a big story arc one. So it's nice to get it going, you know. So like, links in the description for the sauce, all that other good shit. I think it's a really fun story. I really enjoy it. I've been following it for a wee while now, and it's just something to check out, you know. I think it's a lot of fun, and hopefully you guys enjoyed it as much as I did with all the problems that we had. Not my greatest work, if I've been honest with you, but like, we'll just get there. So like, as I say, the sauce is in description, all that other good stuff, and I'm not going to waste your time any longer, so I'll see you then, alright, bye bye.
So I've recently moved Ickbeardia merch over to Teesprings and have a few new designs. Listings are below the video and in the description. So I am an affiliate of NordVPN. If you have been thinking of getting a VPN with everything going on at the minute, NordVPN is offering 75% off a 3-year plan. I have been using Nor myself for a few years now because it helps support a lot of the people I like to watch on YouTube, and I think it's pretty cool they have let me become an affiliate. So check out norvpn.org/Ickbeardia and use coupon code Ickbeardia for 75% off while the offer is on.
Just stop! Just stop it! Stop! No! Just stop it! It's time to stop! It's time to stop, okay? No more! Where the fuck are your parents? Who are your parents? I'm gonna call Child Protective Services. It's time to stop!